I'm a space lawyer. I'm an educator. I study space law. I'm a mom. I'm an avid reader. I'm a damn fine baker. But of all the things that I am, one thing that I'm not is a physicist. Now, don't get me wrong. I support STEM education. I'm an advocate for scientists. I'm just not the sort of person who goes to things like physics lectures for fun. Until that time that I did, and it kind of rocked my career. So back in 2018, my brother's graphic novel club, that's a book club where we read comic books, saw this event come up at the University of Nebraska Library System. It was called The Physics of the Flash. And it was a talk by professor and physicist and super nice guy, Dan Cleese, all about the superhero character The Flash and the physics of how his superpowers worked in the comics and in the movies. And we went, and it was fun, and it was silly, and I learned some physics. Me, person who literally just told you, I don't go to things like physics lectures for fun. That got me going. People also don't want to go to law lectures. What if I, too, could trick people into learning space law through pop culture? So I went to the librarians at the system and I said, space law, pick me, I'm your next great topic. And they said, love the enthusiasm. What is space law? And that's a very fair question, so I'm gonna tell you what I told them. Space law are the laws and regulations that govern what humans do here on Earth to get up into space. Think rocket launches. And the laws and regulations that govern what we do when we're operating in space, like a communication satellite. They said, oh, yeah, all right, that makes sense. What pop culture reference do you think you'd like to use? And I thought about it, and of course it had to take place in space. That's just on brand for space law. But then I thought about how law school is taught. We give students stories, fact patterns. Usually we call them hypotheticals. And we ask them to spot all of the legal issues. And often, the zanier of those stories, the better. The more legal issues for them to spot and think about how they interact. So I thought, well, what takes place in space and has got a bunch of wild stories? There was a pretty obvious fit, and it was Star Trek. So I set it up as a comparative law exercise, and that's just what it sounds like. You take two bodies of law, and you compare them. So, in this example, I took the 1967 Outer Space Treaty, that's very real, and I compared it to Star Trek's Prime Directive. Those are both the main governing bodies of law that say what humans can do in space. Next, I looked at the United Nations Office of Outer Space Affairs, and I compared that to Star Trek's United Federation of Planets, both organizations focused on international or intergalactic cooperation in space. And it was fun, and it was silly, and I definitely tricked them into learning some space law, but it grew. A few months later, I get this call from CBS, like the broadcast network CBS. And they said, hey, we saw the talk on YouTube. Would you want to fly out to Las Vegas and give it at the officially licensed Star Trek convention? Yeah, of course, right? So I get on the plane, I go to Las Vegas, I give this same silly comparative law talk between Star Trek and real-world space law, but with the Star Trek superfans, things got deeper. So, I already mentioned the Prime Directive, and if you're not a Trekkie, don't panic, I'm gonna get you caught up. The Prime Directive says that when the crew, the characters on the show, arrive on a new planet, they're not to interfere with whatever species or culture that they might find there. Think of it like a nature documentarian. You observe, you research, you don't interfere. So then, what would happen if the crew shows up in the middle of a genocide? What would happen if the crew shows up in the middle of an environmental disaster or a pandemic? Their technology could save countless lives, but that aid would be a clear interference in violation of their prime directive. Now, when we step back and we look at Star Trek as a television show, that's a pretty effective plot device. Some of the most interesting stories come from gray areas of human morality, that notion that the law is just, but it doesn't feel right. Likewise, in our real world, some of our most challenging legal and policy issues come from those same places. And often, they arise in contexts that are difficult or uncomfortable for us to talk about. War and conflict, human rights, cultural appropriation or erasure, climate change, gun control, religion, abortion. And my little talk, it got pretty serious. Star Trek got pretty serious. And so just like I'm not the sort of person who goes to things like physics lectures for fun, I doubt very many of us, after a long day at work or rushing out to a discussion group on topics like these, but that's what we did. In Las Vegas, in August, at a Star Trek convention, we had difficult conversations. It stopped being some silly little comparative law exercise, and it turned into a vehicle for discussions that live on the edge of our comfort zone. I found this change in tone fascinating, but outside of a few more talks on Star Trek, I didn't really quite know where else to go with it, and so I looked internally and thought about how I could use science fiction on a smaller scale out of our campus community at the University of Nebraska. One thing that my team did was start a science fiction short story club. Now, I'll tell you, we advertised this puppy across campus. I wanted students from all different colleges, departments, and educational backgrounds and interests to come and talk with us about science fiction. And at our very first meeting, we had 6 engineers. Apparently, come talk about robots didn't have the broad appeal that maybe worked on me, but nonetheless, they were a wonderful group of people. And at one of our sessions, we read a story called The Dead Past by Isaac Asimov, and I won't go into the whole plot, but it looks at themes of trauma and how that might affect scientific research and the type of technology that comes from that research. The main character is married, and his wife only has a few lines of dialogue in the whole story, but her background, her shared experiences, her trauma, were really significant in the outcome of the story. Now, at this point, I should tell you, my 6 engineers, they were all men. I was the only woman in the room. And with about 15 minutes left, I realized we'd never talked about the wife. So I brought her up and I just said, what do you think she felt? And there, in that last quarter hour, we ended up unceremoniously having a discussion about feminism. And later, I reflected on that and I thought, gosh, if I had advertised this as a discussion group on feminist issues, I don't think I would have had the same 6 people. Another way that I continued this work was through scenario exercises and simulations. So I've already told you about law school hypotheticals. These are a lot the same. I write a story, and right around the conflict part, I give everyone in the workshop or the classroom a part to play. Now, in the legal context, that might look like your party A's counsel. How do you advise them? But I've been writing these into a science fiction context and asking everyone to game out what might happen next or possible solutions to whatever challenge or issue we're looking at. And I ran one of these at a conference not too long ago, and afterwards a participant came up to me and he said, that was interesting. Never done anything like that at a conference. And I, now a little nervous, said, I'm so glad you're here. I hope you found it meaningful. And he said, yeah. And he looked pretty introspective. And he said, when I reported out for my group, I kind of sounded like an abolitionist. I said, yeah, the way that you all approached the problem, it was sort of an abolitionist perspective on government and on the issue. He said, I'm a Republican. How did I end up as an abolitionist? Now, I don't think that I changed this person's worldview, nor that of my 6 engineers. But what I did feel, in both of them, and in myself, was a deepening sense of empathy. Playing around in those stories allowed them to see from someone else's perspective. Now, that's true of all stories. In fact, that's kind of one of the whole points of stories. But I do think that science fiction adds a little something extra. My other true literary love, fantasy, asks us to suspend disbelief, to live in the impossible. Science fiction, rather, asks us to look at the could be. And as we look at that could be, we have to confront our current reality. These stories are just close enough that we can see our cultures in them, but they're not so close that they feel uncomfortably personal. It's the perfect sandbox for what could be. Technology, human evolution, it could make premises like Star Trek very real very soon. And again, it's that connection to that possible reality that makes these stories so compelling to readers and to viewers. Whether it's Star Trek, Stargate, Asimov or Atwood, these silly or out there stories, they ask us to examine our most closely held social and cultural beliefs. I started this whole thing trying to trick people into learning some space law. And I did. I did do that. But what I also got was a crash course on how to use science fiction to empower my community and students to take on difficult and hard conversations. And that was my real lesson. Things can be fun and engaging while still being important, taken seriously. We can simulate the future. We can play there. We can reflect on it, and we can grow from it. I believe these stories, these silly little stories, well, they can be our portal to ourselves. Live long and prosper. Thank you.